Futures and options on futures trading involve substantial risk and is not a suitable investment for all types of investors. Past results are not necessarily indicative of future results. When I use the word I in this video, it refers to what I teach in my charting course or what I offer in my twice daily oral and written updates. Prices shown on charts and quote boards are in real time and take into account all known activity up to this point in time. And if you'd like to read more of this disclaimer, simply hit the pause key on your video player.
Good weekend, all. Ira Epstein of Linn Associates with your weekend wrap-up for the financial markets. And this is our weekend edition for Friday, the 27th of July, 2018. I can't believe it's July 27th already. The markets are not through in trading. It's 3:22 p.m. Central Daylight Time. This will be the settlement prices and all the stock indices. You'll be right in this area. Actually, you're closer to 1548 or so in the silver, but you'll be right in this area in those markets. Remember how the markets work. At 3:15 in stock indices, they settle, and then they reopen at 3:30 to 4 o'clock, but the settlements are already determined. At about 2:30, they've determined settlements in the currencies, 12:30 in most of the metals. As you can see, the energy market's down a little bit, probably on word over the weekend, actually on Friday, that Mr. Novak, the Russian oil minister, said that Russia's already upped the production 250,000 barrels a day and that the group might go to that million barrel quicker than you thought and even beyond that. So putting a little bit of pressure on the market as we're there. When we take a look at the monthly chart of the S&P, you're knocking on the door of going back to the all-time highs. You're just not that far away on a monthly closing basis, and that number was 28.2575. You're not far from that. When we take a look at the weekly area chart, you were still up 16 points. By the way, for the month, you were up 96. You wouldn't know that. I mean, it was such a wild week in the market, but you are. And if you take a look, you've been staying over that 18-week moving average of closes. Now, as a market technician, I look at the 18-week moving average of closes as the bias line. When the market is over that, I have an upside bias. Under it, a bearish bias. Generally, the first challenge of it, the way down or the way up, stalls for a bit there as the market tries to figure out what to do next, which would mean if the market would go into a hard break, and I'm not saying it will, I'm saying if, I am saying eventually it will. I don't know what that means and at what level it'll happen, but if it does, wherever that 18-week average is, I'd look for support. This is the current channel that the market seems to be following on the weekly chart. I think you can see that. And as you can see, the all-time high on the weekly chart, and that's the high, this is a bar chart, not just closes, is 28.7850. When we take a look at the pattern, you've got a pretty clear pattern of higher lows, higher highs. That is bullish. When we look at the market bias, you've come down, and this is what I was talking about. It is not uncommon that when you first fall, like you went through it here, but then you raced right back to it, you'll fight a battle. You'll come down, you hit it, and then the market decided to move higher. But from the low, notice how it came all the way up here and fought. Get used to that. It's called the line in the sand. And it acts also as a filter on other technical indicators that I use. I don't know how you'll apply it, but that's what I do. When I'm looking out where the market should run into some resistance, what do you think? The first challenge of the upper Bollinger Band is hit, going on a sideways pattern. This is not the same pattern that you had here as the market kept just running up. Momentum up, trend up, bias up since you're over the 18-week average, and you've hit an objective, so you're stalling out for a moment here. When we take a look at the weekly bar chart on the NASDAQ, if you take a look, the high of the week was 75.30. The Bollinger top is 75.53. We didn't quite get to it. We challenged it. Now you're having an outside week down. Outside weeks can be important because often they give you an idea that the market wants to correct in another way, and you close near the lows for the week. So if you break down, that's fine. The momentum in the market is waning. It's not just pointing up anymore, starting to drift around. The bias remains up here as well. When we come to the Dow, you went right to the upper Bollinger Band, sort of stopped. I think you'd agree right there. This has been what I call the classic sideways action. And from here, if you think about it, what happens in this is the market spins around. Notice it has a higher high and lower low. You didn't get follow through in any direction. Finally, you came back and challenged the upper Bollinger Band. Momentum is still pointing up, but you're at a key resistance point. I would not be surprised to see the market spin around in here for a bit more, but the longer it goes sideways, the bigger the move out of these bands. So you wait and you see, or you try to catch those moves. In the Russell, this is still the market that is giving me the biggest problem as a market technician in terms it wants to drop. Momentum turning down. Now you've got a pattern of, I'm questioning this number I've got, and it maybe should be pointed here. The high back here, if we take a look, I'll tell you if I did this wrong, 1720.80. You came up to 1715, you fell back, and 1711. I certainly have this wrong. It should now be lower highs with a lower low. So you've turned the trend of the market down. I'll fix that next week. The momentum is turning down in the market, but the bias is up. I'm going to call the chart neutral, but this is turned into the laggard market. It was the first to stop making all those crazy highs, but it was the strongest market when tariffs were first announced. In the VIX, I'm looking at resistance between the 100-week average of closes in green and the 18-week at 1467. We got up to 1426 this week, certainly over the 100-week, but not close enough to the other. The market still has a pattern of higher lows and higher highs, but under the 18-week, the two negate each other and momentum is just drifting. In the bond market, the trend remains bearish. You've got lower highs, lower lows. Now remember, we have an upcoming FOMC meeting. We've got a Bank of Japan meeting and the Bank of England meeting. In the U.S., there are no expectations that the Fed is going to raise rates at this point in August. Don't get me wrong, there are expectations, but they're not high. I said that wrong. For the Bank of Japan, the market is flipping a coin. Will the bank decide to mention something and begin, how do I say this, a more sustainable easy money policy than just this open-end buying that they're doing? Whereas the Bank of England, the market's now expecting the bank to raise interest rates. We'll see what happens there. But the trend is down, target 118.28, momentum down. The weekly chart is bearish. TLT, not the same. You've got a pattern of higher lows. This week's low in the market was 119.14. This break low here was higher, was obviously lower than that. So we've got a market that's neutral. Why neutral? You closed under the 18-week average and momentum's pointing down. So while the trend via the swing lines is pointing up, it gets countered by the others. When I'm looking at the dollar index, the 100-week average of closes seems to be the resistance point. It was prior to this the upper Bollinger Band. On the weekly chart, at least, the trend remains up with higher lows and higher highs. The question is momentum starting to slip. You need to see the red line get back over the blue. Now, the red line, whether it's a weekly chart or a daily chart, it's the same exact mathematical formula, but it uses the last 3 weeks of trading on the weekly chart, whereas the blue line represents the last 5 weeks of trading. Got it? So the lines are meant to crisscross each other, and if they start getting back under 80, one would think that price is leading momentum, and the market would be starting to back off on that. In the eurocurrency, you still have a pattern of lower highs, but now you have higher lows. So you've stalled the downtrend. The question is, what happens here? The market is, if you will, just drifting in momentum, and you see that in price. It's not giving us an edge one way or the other. The Aussie dollar has still got a pattern of lower highs but higher lows. Again, I'm going to call that a drifting pattern, not a trend any longer. In the Canadian dollar, we have a pattern of higher lows and higher highs, yet the market is underneath the 100-week average of closes in green and the 18-week. I'm expecting resistance there. Momentum has turned up. So the fact that the market's got downside bias since it's under the 18-week average negates everything in the sense everything goes back to a neutral status. In the Japanese yen, the market has upside momentum running into resistance at the 100-week average of closes. In fact, if you go back, remember, this is a weekly chart since May, actually going back here into April. Since then, you have not been able to rally up and hit that 18-week average. What's been in play more times has been the 100-week. So I have divergence going on. I have momentum pointing up, bias down, and trend down. In Bitcoin, as I see it on the weekly chart, the market has higher lows, higher highs. It closed over the 18-week average. That is friendly. In the Brent versus WTI crude, if we remove, if I can, this week, this is the line that I drew. You had been in a downtrend, getting down to 261. Now, with this week's action, the market has negated that. So now you have a pattern of a lower low, higher high, just so you realize what's going on. And this huge break may have well come to the end. That may have been it now. In looking at the chart for Brent, you can see that the market's been fighting for 3 weeks back against this 18-week moving average of closes. As we take a look at WTI, you see you've got higher lows, higher highs. That's bullish unless 6703 is taken out. If that's taken out because it's under the 18-day average and momentum is already pointing down, that could end up with the market being lower highs, lower lows, putting into play potential. I didn't say it'd go there, but the potential maybe you make a run for the lower Bollinger Band. Bull markets often don't go to the Bollinger Band bottoms. Notice you haven't done this since all of 2018. So that is something we'd want to keep an eye on. In the rebob gasoline, you've got momentum neutralized. You're no longer pointing down. You are not trending. You have a lower low and a higher high. You have fought 3 weeks against that 18-week average. If you can extend the rally, maybe you can get to the upper Bollinger Band, and you haven't been able to hit, again in 2018, the lower Bollinger Band all year. In the Nat gas, you have a market that's caught in the sideways friction of these Bollinger Bands. The market is really not trending. It's got the higher high, lower low. It's back to the 18-week average, just sort of sitting here with momentum pointing down, bias down, but no trend. Hope that helps everybody. Want to remind you, modern trader. And this is pretty interesting because it's technical trading tips from the top pros. We've taken this publication, made it into a PDF for you, how to optimize stops. There's many, many articles in it. To get it, simply call us. You can go to our website and sign up to get these, by the way. And when you do, you'll see our other free offerings that are there. You can click up here if you're watching me on YouTube as well. With that, I'm Ira Epstein. Have a great weekend, and I'll see you all Monday.